surreal soiree. The characters you're about to meet are drawn from the 1974 book Ear Witness by the Bulgarian-born writer Elias Canetti. This evening's program will represent six of these personalities who will be introduced in words, music, and images. We'll first meet the characters as they make each other's acquaintance. After each character will be featured individually before resuming their collective discourse. In Canetti's words, only together can individuals free themselves of the burden of their distance. And this precisely is what happens in a crowd during the discharge, the moment when all who belong to the crowd get rid of their differences. The distinctions are thrown off and all feel equal. In that density, where there is scarcely any space between them, each person is as near the other as he is to himself, and an immense feeling of relief ensues. It is for the sake of this blessed moment, when no one is greater or better than another, that people become a crowd. And now, Canetti Menagerie.
Thank you.
Die Königskünderin, the king proclaimer, has something majestic about her. She realizes what she owes to her mission and is known for her fine treatment of guests. But there is more to it than hospitality, and everyone senses that something special is in the offing. She does not say right off what it will be this time. It heightens the suspense. It cannot be under a king. She never proclaims less. She is tall and stately, and her supply of scorn is inexhaustible. She can tell underlings by the least gesture and keeps them away from the king before he is even proclaimed. But she has a good eye for courtiers, too. She knows how to skillfully advance their careers and uses them for all courts. One can sense the way she gathers her exuberance and reserves it for the grand occasion. She is harsh and despises beggars, unless they present themselves when they are needed. She pays her respects to the whole score of them when the king is about to be proclaimed. Then all the doors of her house fly open. It expands into a palace. Angels sing. Bishops bless. In her new vestments, she reads a telegram from God and jubilantly proclaims the king. It touches her to see the forgotten kings. She never forgets them. She retains even the worst has-beens among them, writes to them, sends them suitable small gifts, attains work for them, and when the honor is long past, she is the only person still to remember it. Among the beggars whom she pays her respects on grand occasions, one can find a former king or two. Die Königskünderin.
Thank you.
the wild catcher, looks around corners and will not be deceived. He knows what is hidden behind innocent masks. He knows, as if lightning has struck him, what someone wants from him. And before the mask falls of its own accord, he makes a quick decision and tears it off. The wild catcher can also bide his time. He goes among people and studies them. Everything is significant. A person need merely crook his little finger to reveal his deadly design. Everyone is after the wild catcher. The world teems with murderers. If someone looks at him, he quickly averts his eyes. The man must not realize that he is unmasked. Let him lull himself into a bit of his predatory lusts and hatch his diabolic plans undisturbed. For a time, the wildcatcher does not mind being thought a sucker. Meanwhile, he starts boiling, and he boils so hard that he can go up in steam. But he makes sure that that does not happen. And he strikes before things come to that pass. The wild catcher collects evil designs. He has enough space and keeps them well and calls his pocket, which is full of wiles, his Pandora's box. He walks softly in order not to frighten masks prematurely. If he has to say something, it sounds gentle. He speaks slowly, as if it were difficult for him. If he looks someone in the eye, he thinks about somebody else as a diversionary tactic. If he makes an appointment, he shows up at the wrong time, much too late, as though he had forgotten it. He thereby lulls the enemy into false security. The enemy has time to form a wrong image of him. Then he shows up, apologizes humbly, and offers a hair-raising excuse for coming late. Under the table, the villain is already rubbing his hands. The wildcatcher then lets him speak for a long time and says nothing. He nods his head frequently as a sign of agreement, gazes stupidly and admiringly, is amazed and laughs and lets out some praise now and then, so far everyone has been taken in by him. The wildcatcher takes his leave, gives the scoundrel his hand, shakes heartily, says ingeniously, "I'll think it over," and starts off for home in order to arrange and systematize the wilds, of which none has eluded him. He has a special gift for systems. After all, everything in the world has a system. Nothing is fortuitous. Every villainy is connected to all others. Basically, it's the same blackguard who, for sham, disguises himself as many. The wildcatcher reaches in with his sharp mind and clutches a whole dense tangle and pulls it out, holds it high, and secretly feels sorry for the creator, who worked so cleverly, and yet not cleverly enough, to fool him. Der Tückenfänger.
Thank you.
Der Hero Züchter, the hero tugger, potters around monuments and tugs on their trousers, the trousers of heroes. They may be of stone or of bronze, but in his hands they come alive. Some get up in the middle of traffic. They had best be left alone. But the ones in parks are the very ones we need. He sneaks around them, or else he lurks in the bushes. When the last visitor has gone away, the hero tugger jumps out, heaves himself skillfully onto the pedestal, and stands next to the hero. He remains there a while, mustering his courage. He is full of respect and does not reach in right away. He also thinks about where the best place would be. It is not enough to put his hand on a curve. He has to hold something in his fingers, otherwise he cannot tug. He needs folds. When he has one, he does not let go for a long time. He feels as if he had it in his teeth. He senses the greatness passing over him, and he shudders. Now he knows what he really is and what he could do. Now he makes up his mind again. Now he tugs hard. Now he glows with strength. Now he will begin tomorrow. The hero tugger does not climb any higher. That would be inappropriate. He could heave himself up to the stone shoulder and whisper something in the hero's ear. He could pull his ear and reproach him for various things. That would be the height of infamy. He could himself, with the modest place that is proper for him, he still clutches the folds in the trouser, but if he works hard, never misses a night and tugs more and more firmly, the day will come, that radiant day when he will heave himself up in a powerful surge and, in front of the whole world, he will scornfully spit on the hero's head. Der Hero Züpfer. Thank you. longer young. She's not all that old either, but old enough to sigh over too much work. She greets the steady customers entering the place. As the owner, or as the owner's wife, whichever, she has the right to be asked how she feels. "How are you today?" "Tired," she says, whether it is 12 noon or 12 midnight, and not without giving reason for her tiredness. If it is noon, she says, "I worked 18 hours yesterday." If it is midnight, "I worked 18 hours today." This sentence is the only thing that does not tire her. She has been reiterating it for years, 100 times a day. She accompanies it with a weepy face, stands up to show how close she is to collapsing, takes two steps, and really does collapse. She makes sure to fall upon a cushioned seat. She does not want to get hurt when she does collapse. As soon as she's properly seated, she casts beseeching glances around her and says, "Tired." But a waiter has done something wrong, failed to notice a guest, forgotten something in a dish. She flares up and starts yelping, screeching away in her language, and keeps yelping tirelessly. The cross she wears on her chest is affected by her excitement. It dances nastily to her words. All her sentences end shrilly on very high notes. Since there are many sentences, every conversation stops. No one can understand his own words anymore. The patrons go mute. Loving couples are seized with anxiety about their futures, and they no longer look into each other's eyes. Scolding, she gets up from her seat, staggers to the counter, personally takes hold of a plate, staggers through the restaurant, changes her mind, and carries the plate back to the counter, where, amid the shrillest squawks, she deposits it without smashing it. No one dares to order anything. Who could possibly wish for anything except for her silence? New customers may come. The tired woman nods by way of greeting and keeps scolding unswervingly. She yelps to make sure that everything is in order. That's why she's there, after all. The cross on her chest gives her strength. Without the cross, everything would be over after three sentences. When she finally collapses on her seat, she peers around, her eyes begging for pity, and whimpers, "Tired." Demüde.
Thank you.
Der Tränenwärmer, the tear warmer. A tear warmer goes to the movies every day. It doesn't have to be something new. He is also drawn to old films. All that counts is that they fulfill their purpose and elicit tears galore. You sit in the darkness, unseen by others, and wait for your fulfillment. The world is cold and heartless, and a man wouldn't care to live without feeling the warm wetness on his cheeks. As soon as the tears begin to pour, you feel good. You are very still and you don't move a muscle. You wouldn't dream of whipping anything, of wiping anything away with your handkerchief. Each tear has to bestow its warmth down to the very lease. And whether it gets to the mouth or the chin, or whether it actually succeeds in running over the throat all the way down to the chest, he accepts it with thankful restraint and gets up again only after a good bath. The tear warmer was not always so well off. There were times when he was dependent on his own misfortune, and if it didn't come and kept him waiting, he often felt as if he were to freeze to death. He twisted about in life uncertainly towards a loss, a hurt, an inconsolable grief. But people do not always die when you want to be sad. Most of them have their tenacious lives and they balk. At times, he was all set for a moving experience, His limbs were already beginning to let go pleasurably, but then he thought he was right on the verge. Then nothing happened. He had wasted too much time. He had to look around for a new opportunity and start all over again with his expectations. It took the tear warmer many disappointments to realize that no man has enough unhappiness in his own life to get his money's worth. He tried with a number of things. He even tried joys, but anyone at all versed in that area knows that tears of joy do not go very far. Even if they fill up the eyes, as sometimes it happens, they do not really get flowing. As for the permanence of their effect, it is rather a lamentable affair. Nor do fury and anger prove to be any more productive. There is only one cause to be counted on: losses, whereby the irrevocable kind are preferable to all the rest, especially when it happens to other people who do not deserve the loss. The tear warmer has a long apprenticeship behind him, but now he is a past master. Anything not granted to him, he gets from others. If these people do not concern him at all, strange, remote, beautiful, innocent, great, the effect increases ad infinitum. He himself, however, suffers no damage. He leaves the movie house and calmly goes home. Here, everything is as usual. He is not concerned about anything, and the next day will bring him no worries. Die Tränen werden. Die Sternklare, the starry woman, shuns the crude light of the sun, and it is indiscreet, the sun. It is tactless. It is painfully bright. There is a great deal within, waiting for its moment, but it is ruthlessly yanked forth, spread out, lit up, and heated, until it is no longer to be recognized just where it was. It really was in him, in her, in all. The starry woman sticks to crystals, which cannot be opened. Even the transparent ones among them are certain of their hardness. If you like to see a thing, you should not have it. The starry woman desires closure on which weak and tested light falls. It may have found its way to her from stars, but it knew nothing about her before finding her, and she listened in her own reclusion for a long time until it came, and was herself uncertain and dark. She has peered through a telescope only once in her life. How ashamed she was. She felt as if she was brazenly hurtling towards a star and forcing it to shine brighter than it cared to. She did not forget how lonesome it suddenly was, separated from the others, which gave it its stillness and equilibrium. She had plucked it out of all the heavens. Her eyes, ordinarily slow and quiet, glared at it, the way the sun glared at her in the daytime. She was afraid the star was destroyed and now lost from the sky. She tore herself away. She cursed the instrument. She did penance in her own way for weeks by making her eyes evade the cursed star. Then, when she dared to seek it again and found it, she was so happy that she purchased the telescope of her shame, smashed it, and scattered the parts and splinters in the night. The starry woman, in relief when the sun is gone and she wishes it would never come again, she spends her days in dark places. She works only to make the days go by. Her skin is as pure as the light of the sun, but she does not realize this is in herself. Her only mirror is the illuminated night, and the mirror consists of so many dots that it has no unity. Where can it start? Where can it stop? Can it be so clear without having seen itself? The starry woman has thoughts. She keeps them to herself. She is afraid of losing them upon uttering them. But they do not freeze within her. They wax and wane, and when they have become so small again as to vanish from her, they awake in others. Die Sternklare. Thank you. And so, now that the proper introductions have been made, our characters gather once again for a final conversation before parting ways. The crowd, suddenly there, where there was nothing before, is a mysterious and universal phenomenon. A few people have been standing together. Nothing has been announced, nothing is expected, and soon, as the crowd exists at all, it wants to consist of more people. The urge to grow is the first and supreme attitude of the crowd. For just as suddenly as it originates, the crowd disintegrates. It has a presentiment of this and fears it. Only the growth of the crowd prevents those who belong to it creeping back under their private